Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Guggenheim. It's so wonderful to see so many familiar faces. We're really excited to be here tonight and to actually hear from two of the reigning queens of performance art and really get into a little bit about what an artist thinks about each other's work and how they make it and make meaning out of it. So I'm Christina Yang, the Director of Public Programs here at the Guggenheim Museum. And I just want to give a few thank yous before we start our programs. First and foremost, I'd like to acknowledge the incredible generosity of the funding from the Guggenheim UBS MAP Global Art Initiative for their support of Under the Same Sun, which is the exhibition that's on view that you will get a chance to see after today's conversation. I also want to particularly acknowledge UBS's funding for education and public programs as part of their initiative, and in particular for their support of living artists. I'd like to give another round of thanks to all of our corporate members who are here with us tonight. Without their involvement, we would not be able to reach the over 1 million visitors that we garner on site every year, and also for the 300,000 participants in our education and public programs. And this is an amazing number, but for the over 6 million people that we reach through our digital resources every year. I'm also pleased to acknowledge Lavazza for their sponsorship of the Italian Futurism 1909 to 1944 Reconstructing the Universe exhibition, and there will be free espresso during the reception after tonight's talk, thanks to Lavazza. And we will also be able to take a peek at the Futurism show, so I hope you can stick around and join us for that afterwards. If I could just remind everyone to not take any pictures while we're speaking, that would be appreciated. And I just want to say a few words about our wonderful participants here, and then we'll go into some more freeform conversation. So I think we hope to cover a range of topics and over some shared themes and shared histories that they have. And then mostly really just want to hear from you directly. I think many of you know Karen Finley for a body of politically subversive and deeply personal performance work, for her uneasy, visceral, and humorous confrontation with social issues, including violence against women, the AIDS crisis, trauma, and censorship. We may go over some significant dates in her career, including the 1990s, when as one of the NEA4, her artist grant was revoked, and then actually given back to her. And we will go over sort of both these artists and sort of a shift in their practice more in the 21st century. Karen is also an incredible writer and educator. In 2012, she completed the Children's Memorial in Gusten, Austria at a former German concentration camp. She teaches at NYU's Art and Public Policy Department in Performance Studies, and she's a fellow at the Kelly Writers House at the University of Pennsylvania. She's received several awards, including an Obie in 1997, a Guggenheim Fellowship, and was the Ms. Woman of the Year in 1997, and she has authored several books and been engaged in many museum workshops, including here at the Guggenheim, the New Museum, and currently at the Museum of Art and Design. So you likely also know Tania Bruguera for her politically charged performances, such as the Totlin's Whisper series, which is on view upstairs as a documentation of a video of a performance work she did in her native country, Cuba. Tanya's earlier installations stage for the participant a suspended state of control and psychological oppression, and her work has been seen in numerous international iterations, including Document 11, at the White Chapel Art Gallery in London, at the MCA Chicago, and in several international biennials in Sao Paulo, Shanghai, Havana, Johannesburg, and others. Her retrospective on the political imaginary was organized by the Neuberger Museum of Art at Purchase College in 2009. She teaches internationally, and we'll hear about her ongoing work with the Immigrant Movement International that was co-produced by Creative Time and the Queen's Museum of Art, and which serves as a foundation for her ongoing piece that's also on view at the Guggenheim, The Francis Effect. Okay, So with our official bios out of the way, I'd actually like to give a chance to Tania and Karen to say a little bit about each other's work and sort of what draws them to each other and what speaks to them about it. Tania, would you like to say a few words about Karen?
I love you.
Yeah. I love you too.
Okay, next.
Yeah, okay, well, let's see. We got some videos to look at.
I think it was when I first knew about Karen's work, it was super important to me because I was just coming from Cuba to study an MFA at the Art Institute of Chicago. And I think I got a very tense relationship with performance at the time because it was a very different tradition of what I have been seeing in Latin America and especially Cuba, as Cuba had a tradition of performance art that I'm part of. And it was more about doing the gesture, seeing performance as a cultural gesture instead of an action, you know? Mm. And it was super interesting to me to come up with a lot of stuff I didn't like in those classes. And then I saw Karen's work and I was like, okay, finally. Somebody I can relate to, so I was super excited.
Fantastic.
About that. So, yeah. and then we met because of you,
right.
And we realized we have so much in common. It's not funny. So, yeah.
The two sisters. Yeah.
Tania, your work I've been familiar with the different stages of your work and your homage that you did early in your career to Ana Mendieta. And I just found that I really enjoyed the spiritual practice of that, of you using the privilege to keep the memory of an artist alive. And that to me, I just found to be very generous. And I just love that idea of being able to be having discourse with artists. And I have loved all of your work that you've been doing in terms of social activism and going into different areas and not being pigeonholed to a particular genre and being innovating the field. And I know what
record?
You mean.
Pardon? Is that on record?
Yes, it is on record. Innovating the field is, I like to think about in terms of performance or, new genre type work is how that we are in research, we are thinking and looking at each other's work, and we can even think about in terms of futurism and the history and how our work impacts each other. And so it's a pleasure to be here.
So I thought we could start actually by looking at some earlier works by Karen and Tania and have them talk a little bit about that moment when they knew that they were going to be working in performance. So could we show the first videos? And Tania and Karen will perhaps...
Ooh, it's getting kind of hot and sticky here on the plastic seat covers. Ooh, real hot. I mean, like, why don't you roll down the windows? And why don't you, like, pull up your dress and pull down your panties and just kind of air it out? Ooh, air it out. Let me touch those young, wet, hot thighs. Let me touch those young piece of wet chicken meat. Let me touch that. Daddy,
it's so
says nursing painting number one. I think that's it for that.
We have one more work of time.
Beautiful.
So having just seen some of these earlier works again, could both of you talk a little bit about beginnings and
well, I'd like to hear about this, the video, what we just saw. I'd love to hear about that. The piece that we just saw here now.
Well, that's so old. I'm so over that.
Isn't that a funny feeling that you feel like it's so old, and what's the relationship to the past?
I think my work had made a shift. I think at the beginning, like this one too, at the beginning I was having a different relationship with the board, like the limitations of how can you say things in a very charged political environment where everything is very clearly laid out for you before you even start to be an artist. And the sense of what is your responsibility as an artist is already being shaped for you, is being told. So I think it was, when I was doing that work, I was more trying to use a symbolic as one of my tools, you know, like, and trying to escape Cuba in the sense of like, not trying to use the idea of something that is a universally understood symbol as a way to escape the borders of the actual moment I was living. And then I realized that was not what I wanted to go. So it's funny because I never showed these pieces you're showing right now. So it's kind of weird to see it because when I do my lecture, my talks, talks about, I never show this one. Because I even think it's the wrong kind of work. Like I go, I went to a process in my projects. I mean, I started doing the project of Ana Mendieta you mentioned, like homaging an artist who was dead and who was Cuban American. And I felt that I really went into a very nice way of talking about the limits of art, which is my biggest interest, like what is art, what is not art, and working between those. And then I did the newspaper in Cuba, that maybe if somebody from Cuba is here, they might know. I did the newspaper piece, and then something happened, like it was some big censorship happened to me. And then I went back to, instead of doing that kind of more blurry work, where you don't know, like it's in real life, it's happening in people's life, not in the museum. So I think after that big censorship and that big kind of traumatic event, I went back to inside and I used all the symbolic ways. Like for example, this piece is called The Burden of Guilt and it's about the history of Cuban Indians who could not confront the Spaniards, and they decide to suicide massively by eating dirt, and only dirt until they die. Mm-hmm. And for example, when I did it in my house in Havana during the biennial, and there were international curators there with local people and the dog of the neighborhood also who entered my house. And it was very interesting to see how people in Cuba in 97 understood what I was talking about in terms of like censorship, in terms of like having horrible moments and sacrifice and so on. And the curators were having a very different take on that, like trying to more. And then I realized the symbolic is not working for me. And I had to do a big shift. And I actually considered that part of my work a mistake, which is interesting. But well, and we're here to talk about everything, so.
And Karen, what about the earlier work we saw in your relationship to history? I'm kind of obviously interested in.
You're thinking about what you're saying, Tania, and talking about thinking about artists and how we look at our work from the past and how we relate to it. Well, when I was seeing the work, I was. This having it in slow motion was speaking to me as, you know, memory and trying to recall and thinking about what is happening in the world today. You know, when I go home, I don't even know what's on the news. It had, there was some type of activity that I didn't have to necessarily identify with a particular group, but that I knew that there was imprisonment or there is difficult political times happening, and then you just felt it. But I'd never seen that, something of having it in slow motion, and it just struck me because usually we're seeing so much of this imagery on the news and everything so quickly. It's just, and so sometimes the work, seeing it now in 2014, I think that it's a classical work, and I think you should rethink it, and I hope that you could be more patient, because I think it's wonderful. I just think it's speaking to what's going on today.
But for me, it's more about how can you control as an artist what you want the other person to feel or to think, more than feel, to think about through feelings. Mm-hmm. And I feel that what I'm doing now, I'm more interested, because I always said that I wanted to do performance because I wanted to go into people's life. I wanted to stay in people's memory. Like, my ideal way of documenting performance in a video or photo is just somebody's remembering when they experience what they experience in the work, you know? And going back into kind of permeating the real life, whatever that is, so the public sphere, for me is more interesting than having this kind of very clear performative acts, you know, like just.
That's
like
more theatrical.
It wasn't, the funny thing, what I don't like about documentation is like, that was super intense when it happened. Mm-hmm. And then because the documentation, because time and so on, like looks very theatrical. But people were there, were, you know.
In the moment.
Yeah, at the moment it was really intense. So I think that's kind of the collage that we have problem with in the medium we're using. So, and over importance. I like very much when you do something and you don't know if it's important or not, or you play with this kind of like, I don't know what's going to happen with this, you know? But,
But performance, my reason for going into it, it was as a political action of going against the art object, that the economics of being a student in the 70s was to kind of reject the art market, or to be subversive, or to interject a shift, so that if there wasn't going to be the object, then that was going to, you know, shift the market. And but I think that with much of performance, then it becoming there was a market eventually for it in that form. So I'm always searching for ways to subvert performance. And I think the way of seeing where it can be of service or where it can be of assistance is something that I like to think of where to situate the artwork in terms of what's a social issue or a concern.
You know, like I had exact, I mean, I didn't have that relationship with the market because in Cuba there was no art market. So, but I was really bored about everything else. I tried everything and I get bored really quickly. So, and performance really
But not having a market is a market, right?
In yeah, yeah, that's true. It's more like an attitude that gives you value. And that can be. But the thing is that for me, when I studied at the Art Institute, I got a lot of problems with the way, I mean, I went there because it was the only place where they were teaching performance. And I had a highly problematic relationship with the way they was taught because it was very North American centric. It was many years ago, it was 1999.
It's probably that way still. Yeah, I think in American education is usually American-centric, right?
And one of the things as a result of that MFA studies was that I stopped calling myself performance artist. And I was calling what I do arte de conducta, like behavior art or conduct art. And I always said in Spanish because I wanted as a kind of political attitude force people in the art world to say in Spanish instead of me trying to learn English for everything that I have to express my work on. So I think that that was a big, and that's what I, you know, I don't identify so much with performance, more like this kind of, there is a tradition in performance that works with behavior, you know, from Vita Conchi, all the, you know, everybody, you, and that's what I'm more interested at, instead of the more theatrical and.
But I think, in America, there is a politics in, with the provocation, and we were talking earlier of not using the word provocateur, but
I don't like it.
Is to challenge, you know, the Hollywood system and to challenge kind of what are the notions of performing or the industries. And that is very important to me as well, is to kind of infiltrate these hybrid forms of what entertainment is. And I think that we have seen entertainment industry being innovated by performing, you know, performing artists. So that is, so I don't want to just lose spite of that, that because when individuals go into characters or they're on stage or that they have an adulation, that there can be a an innovation to their work too. But that I think would be from, especially from an, that's so important in America, especially if you're, you know, living in California, you're there, you're kind of infiltrating those, that industry.
But for me, it was totally, it was very different because we don't have that industry in Cuba. And I actually think the biggest performer in Cuba is Fidel Castro. And politics, so that's what I was going against as a performance artist.
And that worked.
So, you know,
you did.
He speak like 10 hours. You know, he has a Guinness record on that. So.
He did. Wait, he spoke 10 hours?
He has a Guinness record on the longest speech ever in history. So,
10?
I mean, that's
it's
what
a
I'm
10 hour speech? That
like 9 something, I don't know.
Boy, we really are America-centric.
So, you know, but that's interesting because I think in the United States there is a lot of self-reflection in arts. Like, it's a lot about talking about the practice itself and about the relationship different aspects of the practice has, like you say, like Hollywood, identity politics, and so on. Whether, for me and the tradition I come from, is more about the political spectacle, you know? Like, by politicians, not by people who enact certain, you know, ideas or narrative, but it's the politicians themselves, you know. And that's what I'm more interested in. And at some point, actually, I decided in my work not to talk about power anymore, but trying to use the tools power has to do my work. So that's why I did, for example, an art school for political art in Cuba for 7 years. And because I say, okay, what is the first thing power wants to control? Education. So I said, I'm going to do that. So after I say, okay, what's another thing that a political party, so that I'm going to work on that. So I think it's kind of like shifting from representing something to actually doing it through the work. And that for me has been a very important shift. And I hope we have all the pieces.
No, we do, we do. I mean, I think before we maybe leave performance, as we move into this discussion about realism, I actually do want to ask Karen maybe about the work that's up here. And I'm interested in this reference to stickiness and this reference to the body and ingesting. And Tania and I talked a little bit about, again, about performance and the gaze. And actually, we thought it was very interesting the way in which performance in America frequently is constructed for a certain gaze, and how it's different from Tania, how the way she thinks about her work. So I would love to hear you talk a little bit about.
I think in this piece, Shut Up and Love Me, this is the first performance I did after we lost the Supreme Court case. And I like the fact that you kind of got that. We didn't get our grants back ever, but I was going to not correct you, because it's great in terms of the mythology, right? In terms but I had to make a decision about thinking of what could be a way how to respond creatively. And one of the ways I decided to respond was to agree with my enemies, because I was being cast as being this, I am sexualized, but that I was obscene, that my work was indecent. And so with that, I was in Playboy, and I had my performance work really be about sexuality. And this was a ballet I did, and I in Honey, and I also, but it was all parody, and so that's what this work was about. So that I continued that sense of I had performed with Chocolate, but then, yes, there is a third act. And
Antonio, did you want to say something about what?
I'm anti-sexualized body right here,
right.
So I'm it's actually the opposite. So, I don't know. No, I think in my case, I did a lot of mute performances as well, and I felt when I started doing performances with my body, it was like a 101, you have to do that. But at the same time, I realized that once, it was not about sex, sexualized body, it was about the vulnerability of a human being. Mm-hmm. So once I realized that I was not vulnerable anymore, in that state, then I say, why I should do it? I mean, as a performance artist, which I have to say, I love performing. Isn't that the highest, like, better than anything in life, like drug, sex, anything? It's really good. It's really
I don't nice. Like performing.
Yeah, I love performance. I love it. But I don't do it that often, so that's not really why. So the thing is, like, I felt that, I felt like I was in Cuba, when I was growing up, there were very few girls, let's say, doing art, and there were even fewer artists who made it as artists, as a women, female artist. So it was very hard for me, really, really hard for me to make my space. And I think one of the earliest decisions I made in my work was I want to do art. I mean, not this one, of course, but I want to do art that doesn't, you don't know if it's a girl or a boy who did it, like asexual work. So once I started using my body, I had into a lot of trouble because I was a female, very clearly. And when I went to Chicago, I most did all of this work when I was in Chicago, actually. I always assumed that because the female figure has been used for universal concepts like freedom, justice, et cetera, et cetera. Just because I was a girl, I was going to embody all those concepts. Mm-hmm. And it was very harsh to be in this kind of, learning about identity politics and feminism after being so, deciding that in Cuba and then coming here and see that all the different discourse. So I decided I would not use my body anymore. And I had all these people saying like, oh, you're a fan, because you use your bodies. And then I decided to do a performance where I cover myself completely in Kissy Conde with nails, and you don't know who is inside. Mm-hmm. And that was, I got that one passed. But then I did Endgame from Beckett, which is something I still want to do. And everybody's like, well, but you are directing men, so that's also feminist. So I was like, okay. I stopped then being in the performance. So it was hard because I felt also that in the United States, I felt that there were a lot of sections. Like, you had to belong really quickly to, you are the for the first time in my life, I was a Latina. Mm-hmm. I mean, before in Cuba, I was just a girl doing art. And here I came, and I'm a Latina, and I'm all these things, and I'm like dealing with all that thing, and I'm like, and then, yeah, it was interesting, to say the least.
I think entering the sphere of performance and using my body at that time in the 70s, 80s, 90s, was at a certain time in terms of feminism, of using my body and then controlling my body and controlling the gaze, and that was a political moment for me to be able to have that privilege to be able to use that, because I felt that maybe before me, I had this opportunity to do that, and as a female artist. And so it was kind of like a sense of a correction. Would I be doing that work now at that time? I think that it was important at that time. Also, but I've done much other work too, installation work. I've appropriated other genres, and so I consider it part of the body of my work, using the body, right? The body. It is the work that got some of the, I think it was what I was saying that got me into trouble more than what people were seeing. Mm.
Mm. Interesting.
Well, why don't we look at the next slide and talk about a shift, actually, and see where that's taken us.
There's no shift.
Oh, wait, I can do it. I'm sorry.
Oh, you can do it.
Sorry.
Where's that man?
Here we go. So, Karen, can you talk maybe?
So this is the cover of my book, The Reality Shows, and I have been involved in publishing and literature, and I, with my first book, with City Lights, which I did with Amy Scholder, and then I have worked with her in several books, and this was the reality shows that I did with Amy with Feminist Press. And after my court case, Karen Finley just got in the way. I could no longer perform in that vulnerable space anymore because people seemed to know me. I had become a public figure. And so I started creating and performing within a creative nonfiction, starting with the piece I did about 9/11, performing as Liza Minnelli and interpreting the day of 9/11 with other Liza Minnellis in drag and myself. And so for 10 years, I did a series of works where I'd be interpreting and critiquing especially American policy through celebrity culture that I would embody. And that could be I did the dreams of Laura Bush or as Terri Schiavo, that would be dealing with different issues.
And so, Tania, do you also want to talk maybe about sort of your continued works, your shift into real life?
Real reality.
Yeah.
Oh, the real. Okay, so the thing is, like, as we were talking before, I think I had a shift in which I didn't want to use, I went from using my body, like personal body and personal history and all that, into the social body. And I think that was a very important shift. And then, for example, this is a piece called Tattling Whisper Number 5, and it was at Tate Modern, and it was basically, I had two mounted police, real mounted police, coming into the space of the Tate, to use all the crowd control techniques they use when there are uprisings and manifestations, disturbance, with the audience of the museum. So what I liked, I like about that piece is the fact that it's been part of my work, which I don't work with actors. And for me, it's very important not to use somebody who represents something, but somebody who is actually working on something. And that gives me the chance that they have reactions that it's impossible to teach somebody. Because, for example, these guys, they were doing the exercises, the control crowd exercises. And at some point, a girl didn't want to move. Mm-hmm. And immediately, something happened in that policeman. It's like, and then he started being the policeman
right. That
represses people. So I think it was very interesting. You cannot teach somebody to do that. It's something that you haven't learned through years and years. And the other thing I like about that piece is like, no, it was not announced. Mm-hmm. You know, that's something I also worked from the beginning, like the idea of, not the ego of the artist, but the idea of the authorship. I have a lot of issues with authorship and I try to disturb a little bit that. Or question it, and for example, in this case, of course, you are the Tate. Everybody says, "Oh, the Tate," and I say, "I don't want my name anywhere mm-hmm. in the museum. I don't want it announced in the program, anything. I don't want to be part of the show officially." So people did not expect anything from me. So that happened. Like all of a sudden, these horses came and started doing that to people. And people were like, what the hell happened? And I was in the audience because people don't know how I look. And I every 6 months or so, I change my look a little bit. So so I kind of like see. And the thing is that I was in, it was super interesting seeing people like, oh yeah, I think I heard there was a bomb threat or something, you know, like I like the idea, but that series, Tattling Whisper, is all about, and the piece here at the museum is part of the series, is all about taking something from the news that we don't feel connected with or we anesthetized about and make you feel it as your own personal experience. So next time you see it, you have a different emotional relationship with the news. So in this case, every time you see the servant somewhere, you see the horses, you know, it's very symbolic. And yeah, so I think it come people come up with a lot of subconscious reactions they have to unlearn because of the performance. And I'm very interested in that in terms of the behavior of people. And then they had to disappear. Like it was, the performance was really quick. It's like maybe like 3 or 4 minutes, they go away and they only come back like 2 or 3 hours later when a real, like a new set of people is in. And for me, it was very interesting because the Tate bought that piece. Mm. And it was very interesting to negotiate with them part of the, like the one here as well, part of the
agreement
is that they have to have certain, you have to have certain political and social tensions in order to do the piece. Like this is not one of the pieces you can do whenever you want.
Right.
So you have to have a special, in the case of this piece, you have to have a special news happening all around the world, that not in your country, but all around the world, that you are like, okay, maybe I'm also in that danger,
right,
yeah?
Right. So the audience is already
and,
sort of primed for some sort of tension.
So for me it's very important, and I call it political timing specific. It's something I call, that I work with, and I just came up with that. Political timing specific as a way to talk that about, that my work is not only specifically for one place, but is also in a very clear relationship with what's happening politically around at the moment the piece is born or is happening. So it is in the, like for example, if there are some certain tensions in politics, then the piece can happen. But if the day after this disappeared, the piece could not happen. And I really like that.
Yeah, no, I think that's important because we, you know, there's a lot of discussion about how can you recreate performance, how can you restage it, and if you can't if you can't recreate the conditions that it was originally created in, then it doesn't really have any meaning anymore. Mm. And so that it's part of your practice that certain conditions have to exist before the performance can have meaning, actually
because
makes sense.
Because you rely on people's psychological state
in
order to understand the piece and react to the piece. So the same with the piece here, like we had a lot of discussion, like are we going to do it for real, only the documentation? I say,
it doesn't make sense.
That
right
piece
now,
upstairs you only can do in places with freedom of expression is being co-opted and being controlled, so Mexico is coming, so we're doing it there.
Karen, do you want to talk a little bit about sort of your relationship with images and media and sort of your work and the reality shows in particular?
I think that I'm very involved in criticizing or in social critique, and in the thinking about as a way to examine or using sometimes parody and motions of particular female characters, and I'm interested in the archetype of certain celebrities that we select and highlight, and that becomes a transference of some other, you know, engagement or issue to deal with. And in, you know, I guess the images, my most recent work is, I was Jackie Kennedy, who I'm just performing, looking at her images of trauma. Am I really being Jacqueline Kennedy? No, it's a way for us to look at images of trauma and how we document images of trauma. And so that's just, and that interests me, because I think that's what I do like about celebrity culture, is that it provides an intimacy for all of us as a way that we know those people and we have a closeness, and then I like to exploit or appropriate and manipulate the relationships and consciousness that we have by not being entertained primarily, but to be thinking deeper.
Thank you. Why don't we look at another body of work from both of you, which also is looking at certain histories and certain others. And Karen, do you mind continuing to talk maybe about this project?
Yes. Yeah. So this work, and I mean, we have been talking mostly about my performance work, but I've also done installation work, great deal of work on AIDS in the 90s, and installation work. And in fact, I will be performing at Baruch this October my collected writings on AIDS. And this work is, and I, because of time, I'm not going to go into the whole story, and it's, but this is a public memorial that I've been working on with others at a former concentration camp, Gusen, in Austria. And I created this when I was invited to go to Austria when I was doing research and found out about how many camps were there, and the a little bit more of the denial of the camps in existence. And so I created this memorial for when I found out about children dying by lethal injection to the heart, and I decided immediately to start creating a memorial. I work in ceramics, and through I started working on this project called Open Heart, which was to create a memorial out of ceramics and making an abstract shape into a heart. And the difference of how it goes against traditional memorial sculpture is that this disintegrates, and anyone can be making and adding to this heart. And it's through, because of time here, I'm not going to go through the whole story, but it is now at Goose, and I go every year maintaining it, and it's part of Holocaust education, and I travel and work with other people that help adding to it. So I've worked with survivors and families and Austrians, although I am having difficulty, of course, with the Austrian government for the upkeep. That's part of it. And so that's, it's, so that's part of, it's difficult for me to even look at, because it's just an emotional work. And I just returned from Austria in May and was maintaining and cleaning it. And then children, there's ceremonies that we have each year at the site by families and people from around the world come there, and I'm planning to be giving it to be maintained by the by different people, so it becomes a living memorial.
Thank you, Karen. Tania, can you tell us a little bit about the Rigor Movement, and then we'll lead up to a new project.
So, yeah, one of the things that also I mean, I've gone through several moments in which I had to rethink my practice and how things are not fitting. And one of the things I had to rethink is the relation with time and the experience of the work. And for example, I kind of came up with these two concepts, like short-term projects and long-term projects. And the short-term projects are the projects that can happen in a kind of art institution set up in terms of the timing, not in terms of the place, but in terms of like the expectation of how much you're going to learn in that period of time that you can devote to seeing art. So those work are kind of more violent in a way, like because you have to compress all the experiences to like, okay, that person have to get this in like 10, 15, 20 minutes max, you know? So it is really kind of a violent, it's putting people in front of things unapologetically. And then I came up with this idea of long-term projects, which is actually when I'm trying to go into the, you know, like the social and political tissue and trying to change something. And that comes from very naive, maybe, idea that I think art can change reality. I've seen it happen very few times, it's extremely hard, but I've seen that happen. And I think one of the reasons, one of the way this can happen is to be very patient as an artist and understanding how long it takes for change to happen. Mm-hmm. Real change, not the happy change that people are excited about. Kind of, but the real change is extremely hard work and sustainable activity. So I never identify myself as an immigrant because for a Cuban that means a different, other complicated world of discussion. And I didn't want to assume the politics of my country, Cuba, with the immigrants, like people who have left the country, as eliminating them as part of the conversation. So I always force the idea of I'm here and I'm there, so you have to deal with that. And then one day I was in Paris, and it was during the revolt in the Mon-Lieu, and it was the first time in my life that I was in the place where the news were happening. So I was in the street seeing what was happening, and I went home and I was looking at the news of what I just saw. So for me it was very intense, and I actually was very simple. I was walking with friends, and I saw a gun on the sidewalk that was broken. And for me, that was it. And I say, why immigrants have been relegated to have violence as their only mean to speak, either to them or by them? You know, like there is no way. So I think that was the first time I was like, okay, I feel, you know, I have to, you know, different route. And then I realized that what I wanted to do, the original project was to do a political party for immigrants.
Right.
And to actually put them in power, because they have been used all the time as, you know, for negotiations, political negotiations, and once people go into power, they forget them. So I say, well, they can take power. I mean, we are in the global society, everybody's transnational, so let's do it. And then I try in Paris a little bit to work on that, and then Creative Time call me. And it's amazing because I did a 7-minute talk at Pichicucci, I don't know what they call this, at the Creative Time Seminary, and that gave me that piece, so that was weird. After 7 minutes, they're like calling me and they say, well, we want to work with you in a project. And I said, the only reason I will go back to the United States is to do the immigrant movement. And then I came here and I was very struck by the fact, I mean, I never understood like why the way political art happens in the United States has been always like struggling for me, like how this happened. And then I came and I went to the political party, and the first meeting I had in New York was with the super high corporative lawyers in a very big office with 17 lawyers and paralegals and me with Creative Time people. And it was like, do you want to close Creative Time? And I'm like, not again. I'm going to be responsible again for something happening. And I was like, no, of course not, you know. And it was really scary. And then I understood for the first time how, I mean, all this problem about the way in which political art is being structured in the United States only as an educational tool, but not as a way in which you can intervene in real politics. And I think for me that was extremely disturbing. And I had to process that very intensely. And then, I mean, I like creative time, and I call Tom, I don't know if he's here, but Tom.
Here, yeah.
Yeah, I have my contacts on. I know Tom from before, and then he was the director of the Queen's Museum, and I understood that it could not be done only by an art institution, that is very, it has to be with somebody who works with community, have a long history of commitment. So yeah, so I think we came up with this idea, this about immigrant movement instead of immigrant party. Yeah. And I learned a lot. I have to say I was very naive. And I learned a lot through these 3 years about politics, about how things work. And I went to Cuba is very interesting. Cuba is a super hyper-politicized place, but there is no way you can intervene in politics mm-hmm. at all. There is no activism in the streets. There is no community organizations. All the community organizations are officially done by the government. Mm-hmm. And the political party tells you what to say and what to do in the community work. So I think for me it was very fascinating, and I'm very, very happy that I learned so much about, you know, activism and what is called artivism, which is art that is activist, and at the same time is being liked by people in the arts, like valued by people in the arts. And yeah, and I also kind of define more the idea of arte útil, which is mm-hmm. roughly translated as arte útil as útil as useful, but also as a tool, because in Spanish it has a double meaning. And the idea of probably working with a group of people who have no relation with contemporary art at all, mm-hmm. and understanding how can you make people who don't know anything about contemporary art, who don't care about contemporary art, who don't feel representing contemporary art, part of contemporary art. So the project is not only about working with immigrants, you know, it's more about creating a space in which people can create a different culture, ethical culture. When you enter immigrant movement, there is a different mm-hmm. way in which people treat each other, no matter who you are. And we deal with a lot of stuff. I remember at the very beginning, Segundo, one of the guys there, I was talking to him about something was happening, and then some American person, white, came. He immediately stopped talking to me and ran away. Mm. And next time I'm like, no, we have to deal with this. Yeah. You know, in this space, it's not going to happen. Right. So I think it has been very interesting. And for me, the work has not been done yet. Like it was very harsh with critics at the beginning because people kill me. That project, New York Times guy is still suffering that one. He didn't understand anything. He thought by me living in this house with 14 people, that was my performance.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, you don't know what performance is, and I hope my work is not that simple. And that's, you know. And in a way, I think it has been very good. And I think this piece I'm doing here might be the first time I do something that is a reiteration of the piece outside of the piece,
right.
Which I think has been really good.
Yeah, why don't we just go and look at one piece that is on view and still existing, and a piece, Karen, that you did, I think it was a year ago, the Sex to Me If You Can project. And I would love to hear both of you talk about this idea of exchange with the audience, and then, Tanya, you could maybe talk about the actual goal of this piece. Karen, I'm interested in sort of, again, you re-entering your performances.
Well, this work is called Sext Me If You Can, and I'm sure some of us in this room have performed that on our own. But this piece is inspired by wanting to take away the taboo and the violence that comes out and the fear and the shame when people discover sex from people, whether it's going to be young people or whatever, the whole shame that's gone around in terms of seeing or discovering a sext, I think is just a ridiculous overreaction by time and society. So in this piece, what I have, in each place, it can be done differently, site-specific, but here people commissioned me, and I had a phone, and they sent me an image. We had a space in the new museum. I'm sure we could set that up here at the Guggenheim. And they had you know, their 10 minutes and sent me a picture, and the picture, or they would text me. And it was actually one of the most wonderful experiences. It was all completely positive. And then I made artwork inspired by the images that I received in that time frame. And then those artworks were on display. And I didn't meet any of, it was anonymous situation. And I liked the exchange, and I liked using that history of life drawing, because that's what I'm also trained in, and to be using the body, looking at the body, and really using and exploiting and enhancing and reminding us that looking at the body is so much part of the art experience, and to thinking about the composing that goes along with looking at the body. So that's what that work is about. But I'm also interested in museums and the relationships to the public in the museums, and I've been interested in that for many years. And right now I'm having Artist Anonymous meetings at the Museum of Art and Design every other week. And we have a meeting for those whose life has become unmanageable because of art, and mine has, right?
I'm going to the next week one.
And we have artist testimonials, so that so I'm interested in those kind, you know, kind of like more using art as a way to explore other type of psychological and social issues.
Tania, why don't you tell us a little bit about the Francis effect, and then we'll.
Well, you have to sign the postcard you have in your seat.
We will get something back in exchange.
Or not. No, the Francis effect came about because, it's too early to talk about the piece, but the whole idea is to actually is to address the Pope as a head of state and not as a head of a church. And to, through these 3 or 4 years working in the immigrant movement, it has been very frustrating not being able to, as an artist and as a person interested in immigration, to not find a solution where you see corporations having a lot of benefits and a lot of transnational potential. People have problems with mobility and a judgment because of that. So I think, we did in 2011 something I'm very proud of, together with a lot of academics, activists, and so on, a manifesto for migrant movement, which is, I think, is a very beautiful text. And one of the lines says that we want for immigrants the same rights corporations have. So in this case, I feel very frustrated. And my work is, I find my work very funny. Nobody else does, but I do find my work very funny. And I have a very different kind of dark sense of humor, right. And in that case, I feel like this Pope is also, the character he has created as a Pope is one that is talking very much to the left, more than to the right. And I was fascinated how many of my leftist friends are so happy about this Pope and so hopeful. So I feel that all the time my work is dealing with the idea of the propaganda people made, whether a state or a politician. And what I do is a very simple exercise. I just follow their propaganda. And then there you see the cracks in the, So in this case, I'm like, well, if you're so good, just give immigrants Vatican City citizenship. You are head of a state. You can give them a citizenship when nobody else has done that. And the other thing that is interesting for me is the Vatican is the, I can be wrong, but you guys correct me, is the only place I found that is a nation recognized by the UN, if I'm correct. It doesn't have a seat, I think, but it's recognized like the Palestinians. And at the same time is kind of a transnational nation because it is not set up in the piece of land so much. The piece of land is more like a symbol. But everywhere they have a church is kind of their territory somehow, and they have a lot of privileges they could share. So I feel it's that's what I want to do. I want to talk to him as a politician, and maybe, I don't know, we'll see what happens. And the whole idea is like, we're going to get 10,000, we're already 5,300 some, we're halfway, and I promise everybody if we get 5,000, I'm going to write the Pope, so this week I'm going to start my letter to the Pope, asking him for an audience, and so we can bring them all the postcards, and maybe I do the performance there.
We'll maybe.
Maybe that's the performance. So we'll see.
So this performance actually is going on with Tania every day in front of...
And Mariana and Francisco and Chris.
And all her collaborators. Yeah. In front of the museum through October 1st, which is the run of the Under the Same Sun exhibition. So Tania is focusing on getting signatures if you want a private appointment with her.
I'm a little obsessed. More than focusing, I'm really obsessed.
She's obsessed with getting her signatures. But if you want an appointment with her, she takes a lunch break every day, and you can talk to her longer, or on Thursdays when the museum is closed.
Yeah. The other thing that is important for me is what I like, when you were talking about relationship with the people and talking to people and how that can, you know, be part of the work and so on. What I really like about this project is that I'm showing the work in people's imaginary. Mm-hmm. Right. Because what I like the most when I start talking to people, seeing the reaction, sometimes they just like, they're like, oh, wow, that's a great day. So I really enjoy that part of like, instead of showing in the museum, like having the person internalize the piece and staying with it. Hopefully.
Right. Well, I think that's why I wanted to sort of leave with these images, which are a return to the visual. And I think from the beginning, Tania and Karen, our conversations have always been about sort of the tactility of art and sort of this notion that it does exist in the imagination. And that is like the first step towards shifting perceptions and art making a change. I actually want to invite anyone in the audience.
I just wanted to tell you what this image is. This is how I first met you. This is a psychic portrait that I do, and I am psychic, and so I sit with people and do automatic writings and do a reading for them. And so that's been a practice that I did, which is like embodying that whole spirit. So that's what this drawing is.
Tania, do you have anything to respond to that?
No.
Okay, maybe she could do a reading for you.
But I think it would be good, the image here that you have, could you just tell everyone?
Yeah, it's the Pangea, so it's the supercontinent, so it's the world before, whatever billions of years before they separated into continents and way before people thought about nation states. And I'm a no border person, so I believe in no borders, and UN should start giving people passports so everybody can move around. I know it's complicated in terms of like
paperwork
and, you know, and control and stuff, but the means to control people are there. People are being super controlled, so let you go wherever you want. So, yeah, so I think that's well, it's kind of the idea of reuniting again. You know, it's kind of a happy work. It's one of my only happy works, I think. It's very strange.
It's an optimistic work, actually.
Yeah.
So I know we've taken quite a bit of your time this evening, but I'd like to actually invite anyone from the audience who'd like to speak to Tania and Karen to see if they have any questions about the numerous issues that we've talked about. We've really only touched upon.
Can I put some light in the people? Because
I'm they're going to bring some lights up. Yeah. There we go. Now we can see everybody. Does anyone have any queries or contestations?
No?
Or do we just all want to go upstairs, have a drink?
Yeah, that's really appealing to people.
Yeah, I mean...
You cannot compete with drinks.
That's true. Well, we could. Really, no questions?
You can go up to
Would you come to the microphone, please? Because we're recording it.
Wow. I don't know how your funding is. I'm new to...
You're talking to me?
Both of you, as artists. I'm not sure how you are funded.
Okay.
But if you are ever funded by corporate sponsors, how does that fit with your ideas around being sort of subversives around social and political issues, being sponsored by corporate sponsors?
I think, first of all, thank you for your question. And I think that it's much more, I would say that being subversive, I still work within institutions. I live in America. I have money in my pocket. I pay taxes, I'm a professor. So being subversive doesn't necessarily mean that you're, you know, out of the system. So I am part of the system, but yet within funding, I've had issues and concerns, obviously, with funding. But I think that that is a good question. How do we look at and looking at funding and how things mm-hmm. are co-opted and worked? And I think about that all the time, and I appreciate bringing those questions up of who's funding and who's participating. And I think that that's something that both Tania and I think about when we're looking at within work. But there is sometimes people that believe that all money is dirty, all money has some kind, and so use the money, right? Use the money how that, to benefit others. But that would probably, I think for now, because of the time, I'm not gonna expand on it, but I just appreciate bringing that up here today. Thank you.
Well, in my case, I haven't had the luck to be a sponsor by corporations. So I didn't have to deal with that so much, but I've been sponsored and produced by Creative Time, which itself had probably people from corporations, by certain museums. But I think for me, I'm a political artist, so everything I do has to be analyzed from that point of view. And for me, it was very clear at some point in my work that I need to understand who the allies will be for my work. And I have different ways of working. I don't always have to confront people. Sometimes I can go from the inside of the institution and try to change things mm-hmm. from the inside. So I think political work as an artist can take very different shapes and forms and strategies. And sometimes there are tactics, sometimes there are long-term strategies. And I think in the case of UBS, one of the thing is that, of course, it was very weird to let a bank do that and so on. But at the same time, I felt it was very important for me as a Latin American artist and a female Latin American artist to be in this exhibition. And my response to be invited was to talk about immigration. Because if you do a Latin American show in the United States, you have to talk about immigration. So that was my response.
That's beautiful. I'd like to just thank Tania. Thank you. I wanted to add that I feel that it's, you cannot ignore or escape funding or public funding for the arts when it comes to. Everywhere there is going to be some type of public funding somewhere. And I think that nations or government is our largest, you know, if you want to see a corporation of support, and you can't escape it. Or there's wherever you're going to be walking into, there's going to be support. And the problem happens is that these decisions of using indiscriminately forms of whether, you know, censorship or that are vague of when to apply these restrictions. And so that's what is, that's what exists. And, but I really have similar feelings as to what Tania is saying. But I work within institutions, and I feel that that's part of my artistic activism, which is working within the institutions, too, as best I can.
Also, I think it's very important to understand what happens when we work with certain institutions or money sources. I think for me, the most important thing is not to be manipulated by them. You know, if you feel the pressure that they're using you and how they're using you, I think that's very important. As a political artist, you have to be very aware all the time you're working with this institution, like how the balance is going, like how much, you know, is your discourse being distorted by the money you're getting? Or is it, so I think artists doing that who are political need to be very aware of the ironies, the subtleties of the relationship, and understand that sometimes you can change people by working with them, you know, and asking people to do things that, because now they trust you, they can, I mean, it's not glamorous, nobody knows about it, it's done in secrecy kind of way, like nobody will know ever that you was able to put in somebody's institutional head something that maybe was good for somebody else. And that's okay, you know, you don't have to be, so I think that's, But there's a lot of censorship, economic censorship in the United States. an immigrant movement. Like, I see Elizabeth is here. She was the coordinator of immigrant movement for 2 years, and she knows the struggle we had because we applied to plenty of grant money. We never get one grant because it was too political for the artists. It was too artistic for the political grant. So I think it is a lot of conditioning when you get some of those money that is not corporation, but it's also non-for-profit too. So I think it's not only about corporation, which I agree with you. Mm-hmm. We have to also look at non-for-profit and how they work, because sometimes they're doing also some damage, I think.
Other questions? Yeah, come on up, please.
Hi, my question is for Tania. I'm going to formulate it first in Spanish, and then I will translate it for everyone.
I can understand English, don't worry.
No, I think it's important to say it in Spanish.
Okay, good.
Mi pregunta es sobre las postales que están que nos has dado hoy aquí en el Guggenheim, mm-hmm. Y está relacionado con lo que dijiste sobre que no querías tener tu nombre en el Tate, en Londres, ¿no? Y quería preguntarte si imagino que esto es un hecho deliberado, ¿no? Que has decidido no poner tu nombre en estas postales de la misma claro. forma que no querías tener tu nombre en el Google, en el Tate. So my question for Tania was about not having her name in the postcards that are here that she gave us here today at the Guggenheim, and I was wondering if this was related, and I imagine it is, to her decision to not having her name also in her show at the Tate Gallery, and I just would like you to talk about that. Thank you.
Well, I always had trouble with authorship. I think as an artist, I always, as I said before, I question authorship and so on. And I think, I don't know, why is it important to have my name on the postcards? It's not about me. It's not about getting some points, you know? It's about the issue, and it's about people kind of getting what's the name of that? Like a feeling that is talking to them, you know. And I think right now, there is, especially now we have like Jeff Koons' exhibition at the Whitney, and I feel like there is a lot of in the United States focus on the person who's doing the stuff. And I think, not naming anybody, but I think in performance art we had gone through. Some people who know me know what I'm going to say. That we have gone through a very damaging situation when personalities and ego of the artists are taking over the work and kind of melodramatizing
yeah.
the work. And I think my work is not about me. I mean, it's about me in very, very deep subconscious. I have to go to therapy to find out. It's about the artist being not a voice for others. I hate that. Those people can speak for themselves. But it's more about the potential of art to bring certain imaginaries that people might have in their mind or not, and work with that. So you have to be, as an artist, you need to be very clever about step away and not be interfering in the work. So, yeah.
Maybe one more question? Yeah, okay, come on.
Karen, you said that you don't like to perform, and Tania, you said that you do. And I'm just curious to know what it is that you don't like to perform about and what it is that you do like to perform. Does that make sense? Why do you like to perform and why you don't like to perform?
Well, I probably answered that rather facetiously, but I think especially earlier when I would be performing, because the material and the subject matter, visiting it or feeling and being in it, and then knowing that I would be saying, speaking about material that was unspeakable about, and who the audience would be, even just thinking about it right now, I become emotionally affected by it, just knowing that that would be triggered, that it would be in a cathartic experience. And for me, before I would sometimes perform, it's a very physical experience for me, and I take it very seriously, and it's like almost as a trance. So there's a a kind of a wear or a tear on this on the psyche. Although I then later have tried to change my perspective, thinking of it to be joyful, to be thinking, to really transform kind of the process of creating to be joyful and to having that approach towards the experience. And so that's, I do have that, but I am more of an introvert, so I have a bit of a fear in the public. That's the end of my question. Thank you.
Well, Tania, you said to me actually when we were planning this project, the Friends Effect, that you were actually very excited about performing again.
Yeah, I was.
No, it's actually an interesting question because
but I'm performing as a canvassing person who nobody wants to talk to. Yeah. So I really like that.
Yeah, no.
You
I
know,
think
it's
think
not
like
the kind
the
of like
yeah.
like the public. Come here to see me, guys. You know, yeah. It's more about I have to fight over a lot of social construction and social, you know, political languages that people don't want to deal with. So I like that.
Well, and I it does, I will speak, you know, sort of as an institutional person, you know, it does allow us to do a lot when we can actually say the art, this is an artist project. This is Tania Bruguera's project, The Francis Effect. This is Karen Finley's class. And so, I mean, we know that we believe in the work, in its social value, in what it gives back to all of us. But I think, you know, we're here because we think artists are.
But before we get so happy, let me ask you a question. I have a question because that question about not having my name, we're going to do the banners.
They're going
to have my name. Can you talk about that? Because that's an interesting thing. Like, we're going to do the banners around the museum with the image and whatever, and then they had to put the name, which I don't like.
Right. So, I mean, this is something that we can maybe leave you to think about, that when artists are working in the public domain, whether it's, you know, billboards, whether it's on the street, whether it's canvassing, the museum can only do so much, actually, the museum actually cannot be a lobbyer, and we cannot be advertising for a certain cause. But we can do a lot, actually, under the name of an artist. Mm-hmm. So, in fact, as much as Tania's name is not on dignityhasnonationality.org, the museum actually very much wants to author the piece. So
that's always the tension I have as an artist.
Yeah.
Actually, in immigrant movement, we have that tension too. Like, no, that's your work. You're the artist. I'm like, no. Like, everybody can do stuff. I mean, it's a collective.
So
that's interesting how the institutional structure is ready or not to deal with those.
Right, and we're following artists actually lead in this sort of new area of
I'm just saying
art.
That because in months they're going to see the banners with my name and they're going to say she's a hypocritical.
Right.
Person.
We just want you to know that it's okay. It's
sure
all complicit.
That's on the record. Okay. Sorry.
You know, I think we've actually probably taken the time that we said we would take.
Okay.
I'd like to actually thank the audience for being with us tonight, and I'd like to thank our two amazing artists that have shared quite a bit of their practice and passion with us.
And Christine, I'd like to thank you so much for your preparation and having us here.
Thank you.
I also want to thank you because it was amazing when you said to do this. I was so like, I mean, I didn't realize how much we had in common, and for me, it's a huge opportunity to be here with you. Thanks.
You're very welcome.
Thank you, Christine. It's really wonderful to work with you. It's a joy and it's a pleasure. And I want to say that I love the Guggenheim. Is this the most wonderful room to be in? I just have to tell you, I love being here, and being in this museum is such a treat. And I love being in New York because of the way, I just love the architecture and the quality of the shows they do here. Thank you, everyone.